I have your brand new CD right here in front of me. If I hadn't seen the cover and had just been played it out of the blue, I don't know if I would have realized that you've changed half the people in the group. That's three new people out of six. Not only are there three new people, you've got one Mexican, one African, well, from Cameroon, and you've got a Vietnamese, which makes it a really international lineup. Did you have any idea of making it that international when you started making changes?
Actually, I didn't notice that it was so international until about a week after I hired everybody and somebody pointed it out to me.
Right.
I don't really think too much in terms of nationality or styles of music or these kind of broad generalizations that are found throughout our culture in such abundance.
Mm-hmm.
To me, they rarely have much true meaning to the reality of either the person or the music or, in anything other than in sort of these kind of broad, washes of category. To me, people are people, and mm-hmm. I don't really feel that there's any particular advantage to being this, that, or the other thing.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, especially within the world of music, it's so much about the individuals and the particular individuality that a human can bring to music is kind of a defining characteristic, particularly in jazz, as to mm-hmm. what it ultimately sounds like. And those things of internationalization and all that is applied to music are sort of intriguing on a cultural level or something to talk about in an interview. But I mean, mm-hmm. in the reality of music, once you start playing, it just doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm. Right. Well, certainly, it, as with all of your other records, it has your own personality stamped extremely strongly on it. On the other hand, I'm sure from your point of view, each one of these musicians must have brought something distinct to the mix as well. Would you like to talk a little bit about all three of the new members?
Well, one thing that's really interesting about this lineup is that it's the first time in the long history of the band that we've had guys in the band that are chronologically clearly one generation younger than the rest of us.
All right.
And that's maybe the most significant thing about it, in fact, is that all three guys are amazing musicians, very established in a way in the jazz world in their own particular zones.
Mm-hmm.
That are quite separate from each other. I mean, when you look at the areas of music that those guys sort of are known for, they're quite spread out across the jazz panorama.
Mm-hmm.
But the one thing that they all three have in common, strongly in common, is that they all three sort of grew up with a part of their musical DNA formed by listening to Pat Metheny Group records.
Right.
And their enthusiasm and curiosity and interest in some of the earlier group records, I think, really affected us in a way to kind of like, to hear them talk about it over and over again. I think it caused us to kind of look at those things again and sort of go, what were we actually doing then that was so cool that these guys are talking about it that much? And, to filter their particular talents through the sort of historical perspective that I guess this band represents was part of the inspiration of it all, was to kind of say, okay, well, like for instance, Kung Vu is this amazingly interesting trumpet player who has a very unique style, but I mean, his favorite record was Still Life Talking, and it's sort of like, well, how can we reconcile what his talent has emerged as being with the sort of melodic component that made up that record. And, Richard's voice is obviously amazing, and it's sort of like, how can we utilize that?
Mm.
Antonio Sanchez, the new drummer, is one of the most talented musicians I've ever known, and certainly one of the great drummers to show up in jazz in many, many years. And he offers, like, this incredible range of stylistic opportunities that's very unique to anything we've ever had before.
What's so different about his playing from other people you've worked with to date?
Mm-hmm. Antonio is one of those guys who sort of is stylistically open to all different kinds of things and can sort of play all the music that he loves. By that, I mean he's primarily a jazz guy, I suppose, like all of us are primarily jazz guys. Mm. But, you know, he's very familiar with all of the different ways that rhythm is sort of underneath all kinds of popular music. Mm-hmm. And he can really play, you know, like pretty much any beat you could imagine, he could play it.
Uh-huh.
It could be in some weird time signature, it could be something that requires a very strong backbeat, can be a loose kind of jazz thing. It's sort of all within his range. But the thing that I think separates Antonio from just somebody who's a very versatile musician is that he does it all with this distinctive sound and distinctive personality that makes it sound like jazz. I mean, it's not just kind of generic. It's a very particular way, particular touch that he has that's really connected to like Roy Haynes and, you know, great jazz drumming, but at the same time it sort of can be any kind of groove you can imagine he could play.
So the possibilities for new sort of things happening live, I would imagine,
definitely.
They present themselves again.
Yeah, we wrote very complex music this time rhythmically. I mean, it's more detailed probably than anything we've done, or at least it rivals anything we've done in the past. And the thing that's great about Antonio is that it wasn't just a matter of like, okay, will we be able to survive playing through this? He can play it different every single time and still take care of business. And he's just the greatest. I'm so excited about him.
So was the writing process a lot different this time, having three new people in the group?
Generally, the way the writing works is sort of one of my main jobs as the leader is to sort of set a tone and kind of establish an area of interest that the record is going to be focused on. And for me, before I got Lyle out, before we did anything, I wanted to see if I could generate some melodic material that had that sort of inevitable thing, sort of intrinsic to what the melody is, that it couldn't be anything other than that I think it is embodied in some of the better tunes that I've written over the years that have, you know, really strong core melodies. So I really just wanted to generate as much melodic stuff as I could. The next step was to call Lyle Mays, my longtime partner, great piano player, great collaborator, and we basically go through everything that's available and try to find the things that suit the project best. And in this case, filtered through all of that was the idea that we were going to have Kung, this really interesting trumpet player, singer, improviser, and also Richard, who is to me just got the voice of the universe, you know, to kind of focus on.
He was here just recently doing some gigs, and I was wiped out. It's one of the best performances I've seen in possibly a few years, actually. The guy was just stunning.
Richard is an amazing force in music, and the fact that he's doing this gig with us is something very special. And, you know, I think that, you know, at the time that I hired Antonio, I was very seriously considering just making it a quartet again, just with Lyle and Steve and Antonio, because really, there was more than enough going on with just that group to, you know, fill up all the space and that we would need to fill up. But I decided if I were to hire any other extra musicians, I wanted them to be very personal, very unique kinds of talents. And I called up Richard, not especially thinking that he would be the guy, but I thought he might know somebody. You know, and when I called him, I described what I was looking for, and he said, well, you know, I've got the perfect person, it's me. And I was like, well, you know, first of all, you're a bass player, and I don't need a bass player. I've got a bass player that I'm very happy with, who's been in the band for 20 years.
Right.
And plus, you're famous. You're like, you know, right. You've got all this stuff happening, you're making your own records, you've got your own thing going. And he went on to explain to me, first of all, that this is just a gig that he had always wanted to do. He had really followed this band and kind of always pictured that he would love to do it at some point. And also he went on to say that, you know, playing bass is just one of many things he can do, that percussion, in fact, is his first instrument. And did I know that he could sing? And of course I did. He's one of my favorite singers. And
Singing is very influenced by the sound of your group as well.
Well, that's, you know, it's a two-way street. I mean, very much so. And you know, he said, look, I want to audition. So I was like, okay, you know. And so he said, tell me a couple tunes to learn. And I told him a couple tunes. And we got together, the five of us. And it was fantastic, of course, because he's incredible. And I kept asking him, are you really sure about this? You know, I mean, you know, you really want to do this for a year or something like that? He says, I really want to do it. So we're very happy to have him, you know, on the record. And also he'll be touring with us when we tour, too.
Yeah, right. Yeah, he said he was going to be playing guitar on stage as well.
Guitar and anything else we can give him back there, and we'll incorporate his bass playing too.
You know, he's actually featured on, was it high string bass on a couple of tracks?
He plays some little soloistic kinds of parts, but I mean, live we're going to have to find some stuff where he can really stretch because he's such a great bass player.
Yeah. And Kwangvu, this is a completely new name to me. I read on the press release how you heard him on internet radio.
I did.
Perhaps you'd like to tell the story of it. This is a great story.
It's a very modern exchange of information that occurred between Kong and myself, which is I got a new Mac, and on all Macs now they have this thing called iTunes. Mm-hmm. And in the iTunes thing, there's a thing that's got all these different radio stations in this sort of subgroup category. Like, it's not just jazz, it's like jazz, house, trip-hop, jazz, you know, or something. It's all this stuff. So I was like, well, what are all these categories? And I clicked on one, and they were playing this really interesting trio of trumpet, electric bass, and drums. Mm-hmm. I thought, wow, it was great. And I just was so impressed with the originality of it. And at the end, it said Kong Vu. And I really, you know, that could be the name of a band now or something. Mm-hmm. I mean, it just was like, Kung Vu, what's that? So I, like, copied and pasted it, you know, like, mm-hmm. and then put it into a search engine that was right there, Sherlock. And then it came back and told me that Kung Vu is this guy and that he had an association with a lot of, you know, what they call the downtown scene in New York, even though none of those guys actually live downtown, but they call it the downtown scene. you know, it gave me some background on him. So, and then I found out what his records were, and I got a couple of his records. And then I wanted to just compliment him on having achieved that level of originality. And I couldn't, for all the people I know in New York, I couldn't find anybody that intersected with any of the people that he knew. Mm-hmm. So finally, I just called information. Mm-hmm. And said, you know, Kung Vu. And I was like, how many Kung Vus are there going to be? You know, maybe there's going to be 100 or maybe there's just going to be one. And there was just one, and it was him.
It was in Brooklyn, yeah?
In Brooklyn, right, of course, which is a natural place for somebody, a musician of his ilk to be living. So we got together, and in the meantime, I found out he also was a great singer on one of his records. He sings one track. So. Mm-hmm. Kind of in the back of my mind, I was thinking, this could be worth looking into. And I mentioned to him, you know, the group was getting back together and blah, 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 to which he responded with this unbelievable enthusiasm about the group. He had been to all of our concerts as he was growing up. He had all the records, followed everything about the group, and really knew the group's music inside out, which was kind of a surprise to me because his own thing is quite stylistically removed from anything having to do with the group. Huh. Yet at the same time, there was something about it that got me to the point that I went to all this trouble just to, like, get in touch with him. So,
right.
I mean, it was a very sort of digital exchange of interest in each other that occurred that was pretty 21st century.
Mm. It's hard to tell from just listening to the record how removed the rest of the music he's doing is. I mean, I don't know how easy it is to describe it. What would be, well, the thing that you heard on the internet station, what kind of music was that?
Well, I mean, for lack of a better term, you could say avant-garde, I guess.
Okay.
Although that really doesn't quite do it justice because, in fact, it is extremely melodic what he does as an improviser. But structurally, he's playing more or less without changes, which generally that's what people think of avant-garde music as being, I guess.
Right.
I mean, it's not based on chords as much as it's based on sort of sounds. Mm-hmm. And yet at the same time, his own thing tends to be pretty much, I would say, rhythmically connected to rock. I mean, you know, it's more even eighth note based. It's not so much triplet kind of
okay. music. Again, from the press release, there was a quote of something you said, which took me a little bit by surprise. I may be misquoting here, but something like, to talking about the Pat Metheny group, this group is all about bebop, although we never actually do that, something like that. And I'd never thought of your group as being all about bebop. In fact, it seemed to be one of the main protagonists in expanding the jazz vocabulary away from that. I was just interested to hear your thoughts on that.
In the context of that quote, I would be using the term bebop in its most expansive possible way as a term that invokes playing linear improvisational music that involves detailed harmony.
Okay.
And in that sense, you know, that may be the ultimate definition of what bebop, you know, as defined by Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, and later, you know, if you want to include John Coltrane
okay.
in that world, you know, that way of thinking about harmony in a sort of linear sense, in a very advanced way, may be the most important legacy of what that period offered subsequent mm-hmm. musicians. And mm-hmm. the standards that they set through playing on, you know, those kinds of structures, I think, remain a model. And yet at the same time, most people who get good at playing, you know, quote-unquote bebop, just want to play it for the rest of their lives because, mm-hmm. First of all, it's hard to get to the point that you can play it good.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing is that it's somewhat addicting. I mean, if you get so you can really play great on standard tunes and on conventional forms, you kind of just want to do that. And our thing from the beginning was that we had come up with that as a foundation, but at the same time, I really wanted to try to find alternative ways of thinking about melody mm-hmm. and harmony, and yet at the same time retaining what was the best of the narrative qualities mm-hmm. of that kind of improvising.
Mm-hmm.
And also, I always wanted to play music that had a lot of chords in it. I was never really interested in that thing of playing on one chord, which mm-hmm. was, and to a certain degree, still remains a very popular thing to do for certain kinds of jazz musicians.
Mm-hmm.
For me, I just never really was interested in vamps.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that's what I mean when I say that it's based on bebop.
Okay.
That kind of linear, really detailed harmonic way of thinking is the foundation of everything we do.
Some people shouldn't be allowed to have children. I gotta go.
What's he got?
Same thing he had when you sent him off to school this morning.
Please.
I used to think if you fell from grace, it was the result of one stupendous error.
There's some wicked things I'd like to do to these kids.
Shh, careful or I'll report you.
Hey, can I take the girls?
Are you sure?
She said there's wicked things I'd like to do to some of these kids.
It's hard for me to see you right now.
We have to get on with things.
Howard!
Conduct and reckless endangerment of a minor.
Three other children have come forward.
You think I'm innocent, don't you?
What happened to you?
Get me out of here!
I said you're hurting me!
I don't know anyone here.
Would you allow your daughter to stay unchaperoned with the Goodwin family at this time?
How many times is it now that you've done a complete soundtrack? Three?
There's more than that. There's about 9 or 10, actually, but most of them are really obscure.
Wow.
But, yeah, I mean, you know, writing music for films is something that's quite unlike any of the other activities in my life as a musician. It's, you know, there are connections with what you do as an improviser in the sense that you're dealing with specific moments in time, and you have to be really clear about what each moment offers. And in the sense of a movie, you're responding to and hopefully enhancing a literal narrative thing.
Right.
And also because movies projects generally are very fast, there's a connection between what you have to do as an improviser. I mean, like Map of the World, I basically had 10 days to write an hour's worth of orchestral music and play it and everything else. So, I mean, it seems like every score I've done, it's been incredibly under the gun. And
Do you work well in those kind of situations?
I have the capacity to work for long periods of time with no sleep, so in that sense, yes. But, you know, the people that do scores year in and year out and do 8 or 10 a year have my utmost respect, because it's a hard, hard life, you know. Mm-hmm. And it's also an area of collaboration where, you know, every single person has an opinion about it. There's millions of dollars at stake, and there's no time.
Right.
So it tends to be very high pressure, and, you know, most of the guys that are film score guys, when you see them, they look about 20 years older than they actually are, and I completely understand that.
Do you have to feel an identification with the story as well before you get involved in a project like that?
I really do, and in a way I have the luxury of sort of picking and choosing ones that I do get that connection for.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, I get lots of opportunities to do scores, but most of them I'm just not that interested in the subject, or I don't feel a connection with what's the message of it is. And you know, in the case of Map of the World, it's a very sad story, actually, but it has at the core of it a message of sort of hope that I think is I could get behind. And usually the way it works for me is that when I read the script, I know right away if I could do it or not. You know, it's like I almost hear it, and it's even before I see anything. Before I see any of the rushes or a rough cut or anything, I already know if I'm going to be able to find a way into the subject. So I get lots of scripts and I say no to most of them, but every now and then one comes along that I feel like, oh yeah, I can do that.
Oh, hi, Wilma. Edgar, how are you? I like it in the car.
When's Mommy coming home?
Soon.
When's Mommy coming home?
Soon.
Hi, my name is Pat Metheny, and you're watching Wow Wow TV.
Jazz File.